bring it all back to earth and something that doesn't receive quite that much rainfall. So I'm talking about up north today and our experiences with native grasses in that environment. And this is a beautiful photo one of my colleagues took from the top of a hill, and that hill and distance many of you would have climbed if you visited the upper north, and it's made a beautiful scenery. You can't actually see the scenery from the top, but this is the outlook. So the upper north, we're talking about areas that include Jamestown, Peterborough, Oahu, so the north of our state. About 310 millimetres of rainfall on an average year. 75% of that falls in the winter period. Most of those farmers in this environment are wheat sheep farmers. And with that comes their income. Most of their income, greater than 70%, comes from their wheat enterprise. But in the lead up to sort of 2006-2007, they'd had a run of probably seven, depending on who you talk to, bad years, where their income went from 70% based on their wheat enterprise to about 0 to 10, sometimes minus 70% came from their wheat enterprise, and most of their income had to come from their sheep. So all of a sudden we had a group of producers who were suddenly saying, how can I better manage my sheep? How am I going to feed them? And a colleague of mine who's an agronomist sort of thought of that, sort of native grasses. I'd moved into the district and moved back from New South Wales, and they sort of thought about pasture cropping, which was sort of a fantastic concept. And so we looked at that as an avenue for these producers to manage their risk. And you know, could we use their native pastures they had to grow a cereal crop on an occasional basis? So our first test was to actually find some native grasses. And coming from New England, you know, where they didn't meet Armada, to the upper north was a bit of a shock to me. I did actually manage to find a really beautiful patch of Enteropogon or curly windmill grass, but most paddocks I saw looked like this. They existed of barley grass and water beets. And I thought, no, there has to be more grasses there than that. I couldn't find grasses anywhere. So I grew some, took soil cores, we sent them to State Flora, and we grew out those soil cores. And I still didn't find native grasses. But what we're dealing with here is a legacy of decades of cropping, high levels of erosion, and inappropriate management through grazing, their grazing management through their socking. So we just didn't have any native grasses. But occasionally we did find some spots of native pastures, mainly spear grasses and watery grasses. So we did undertake pasture cropping in those environments. This is a fully replicated trial we undertook in 2006, and I think this is the only day it was green. It's the only photo I have of our green pasture cropping, because that was, I think it was well below average rainfall in that year. Most of it looked like this. So we pasture cropped into a stipend Jamestonian grassland. So we had, the other issue we had in this environment was, because it was so dry, we ended up with mobs of emus in our crops. Did sort of suggest to the producer or the farmer that hosted this site that he could actually sort of camp out there and get rid of them so I could actually have some results. But you know, it was just waves of kangaroos and emus moving through these sites. Despite that, we did have some really good outcomes from that. We had a look at, so how did tillage affect those native grass species that were present? So interestingly, it didn't actually affect the curly wimble grass, but we had quite a significant effect on both the wallaby and the spear grass. I think that's to do with, you know, when I look back at that now, you know, this is 2006-07, it was about the size of those tussocks and about the strength of those tussocks. The other benefit we had through undertaking pasture cropping and the associated activities with that, so chemical control, cultivation, we had a huge reduction in the number of weeds in those pastures. Hardly surprising, but a really good benefit to some of those producers, where they could then look at going back into regular crops. So during this pasture cropping phase, get rid of your weeds and then go into regular cropping when seasons are a bit better. The other benefit we had was about recruitment of native grasses. I was a bit sort of surprised that we had such huge recruitment, both of wallaby grasses and spear grasses in those pastures. And interesting, that pasture cropping really didn't affect the yield of the cereal that we were growing compared to a control in those years. So the really good outcomes for these producers at this time was, by undertaking pasture cropping on that occasional ad hoc basis, minimise their risk, both economically and environmentally. We weren't dealing with a paddock that was bare and had no cover, but we also were minimising their risk from an economic side point of view, and they could utilise their trained pastures. So then these farmers started to dream, and like all farmers, they love machinery, and one of the farmers had this in his back paddock. And I couldn't find the photo of Bob Mars coming up to inspect this, when this group of farmers said, well, let's convert this machine to sow hundreds of hectares of, for pasture cropping and or for restoration of native grasses, because we've gotten that. You know, and I said, well, yeah, okay, guys, excellent, this is a great idea, introduce them to Bob. We had lots of discussions. So I thought I'd better take them to where I had experienced my background in native grasses and have a look at how other people were undertaking pasture cropping and sowing native grasses. So I took them to New South Wales. We had a look at four properties, including the Department of Ag site, where they were doing pasture cropping. And we had a look at some machinery to sow native grasses. So we went and met Cole Sykes. He'd actually been over to some of the sites before the guys started, but it was fantastic for the farmers to go and meet Cole, see his property and see what he was doing. And then we kicked some tyres, as all farmers like to do, and we looked at machinery. And we looked at machinery. And we looked at more machinery. I'm a farmer's wife, or I'm a farmer as well, but machinery doesn't do it for me, but you know, these guys loved it. So we came back with all these ideas about how to change that into something that we can utilise in the upper north. So we're talking about hundreds of hectares, not 1-5 hectares. We're talking about big scale. So that led to a project with these guys looking at a whole range of things, because it all of a sudden, you know, they had all these questions about native grasses and we couldn't answer them all. There wasn't enough, you know, the science was sort of out there a bit. But how did we apply that in up north? Because a lot of stuff came from New South Wales, Victoria, C4 grass dominated, so all summer grasses, you know, quite a different environment, much higher rainfall. So we had a whole host of questions. So Chris Penfold came up with his machine, and we sowed some areas, and the guy said, well, this is great, but I've got 100 hectares I want to grow. Or so. Yep, excellent. So then this beautiful machine that the guy had out the back, we converted it. We took off tines, we put new points on it, we changed all the hoses, and we had, you know, we had a machine we could use broadacre. And then we went, well, where are we going to get the grass seed from? Because the insurers couldn't give me enough to sow 100 hectares or sell me enough. Well, my ass couldn't produce it. So we borrowed the Mid-North Grasslands Working Group seed harvester and we went wild harvesting. And you know, farmers loved this. We sort of got this gadget. And then they designed this, which was their own Upper North Farming Systems seed harvester, which can easily be attached to a tractor or a tow behind a ute, so that they could harvest seed when they needed to with whatever machinery they had, fully adjustable with hydraulics or manually adjustable. And then we had the issue of seed planting. So we sort of had this chloris or any other plant, and was like, well, how do we get that to some sort of format that we can put through that air seeder? So this sort of lots of beers, I think, by these guys, these farmers, and we ended up with seed planter in that bucket. Some chloris seed has come from that seed planter. And then they said, well, it won't necessarily flow if we've got wallaby grass or if we've got red grass. You know, how do we get it to flow through that machine? Despite the bleeding, we still can't get it through. So I think many frustrated days were spent by some of these producers looking at various mechanisms about how can I coat the seed, how can I get it carried and make the seed go through the machine, and they trialled a whole host of things. And I guess probably no surprise, whatever seed coating or carrier you want to use is seed specific. So which species are you using, the carrier and the coating generally has to be specific. Some are more floppy than others, some only need a carrier, some need coating. And I guess behind all these, I was sort of thinking, oh my goodness, I've got these five really keen farmers who are dragging all their neighbours in, but how much interest is there in the broader community? So we undertook a survey of landholders, not only in the I have to move to later on, and we ask them a whole series of questions about what sort of plants, perennial plants particularly, they're interested in having sown, what's been successful, what do you think about perennials, what are the barriers, and a whole host of other questions. And I guess with no surprise in that environment, the most common perennial planted was saltbush. A few had dabbled with lucerne, and a couple, might be more than that, had tried some native grasses, and I was really disappointed that they were completely anonymous, because I would have liked to have gone and found those farmers to find out what they did. So then we also thought about, well, which species do I put in this 300 mil rainfall that's winter dominant? So it's pretty obvious from our surveys that, you know, speargrass, wallaby grass were there. We could find a bit of forest. But what were the other grasses that might also grow in that environment? So we undertook some trials of various species, including redgrass, bluegrass. The important component for producers in this environment is a legume. So we trialled a whole host of legumes, medics, clovers, culms, you name it. So it's a fully replicated trial where we just sort of went in with no conceptions about what's going to grow in this environment. It gave us the answer to that question, but I think it importantly also helped educate those landholders in that environment about, well, what is a native grass? What do the different ones look like? What do they look like when they're this big compared to this big? It was an amazing sight, as you can see, in the middle of the upper north that really gained a lot of momentum for those landholders in that environment to sort of participate in, you know, sowing native grasses and using them in their enterprise. And then all the time during this work was going on, the landholders have been thinking about, well, how do I get this seed out for what acre? Because the machine they'd sort of designed, we had depth control problems with, we couldn't move it between Peterborough and Jamestown. There was a whole host of issues. So they came up with this. One of our producers is an engineer, as are his two sons. So this is their invention, I guess, a take on with a small box, and that's all air-driven. So native grasses. And we can easily move that across the region. The other question that we were asked a lot was, well, how valuable are these to my sheep for my livestock enterprise? Few producers knew that speargrass had a few issues with vegetable matter in their wool, but what was the actual nutritional composition? So we undertook some work looking at about 10 species and looking at their nutrition. And I guess this led all the time to some work that we'd been thinking about. It was about, we've got all this information out there, how do we integrate that? We had a whole heap of grassland projects occurring across the state, from the southeast to Eyre Peninsula, mid-north, Adelaide Hills. We need some sort of coordination. There was this growing scientific interest in the community. We needed grass seed. That was a really fundamental driver. And there was a need for some guidance at that time, and probably still today, maybe, to NRM, about, well, what do you do with native grasses and great grass ecosystems? So, That drove an application to the Australian government through the Upper North Farming Systems to look at the strategy for native grasses for South Australia, focused very much in this instance on agriculture. So the strategy looks at various components, so seed production, sustainable ag production, so it brings together all the information from grazing and inputs, fertiliser to spraying, looks at land management aspects, and then has a series of recommendations. We were lucky enough to also receive funding through the Australian Government, through the Eyre Peninsula Natural Resource Management Board, to have a second project to develop a second strategy, looking at sustainable production and biodiversity conservation. So we had the very agricultural focused one, and then one looking at a sustainable production and biodiversity. So that looks at a whole heap of ecological information. Ask the question, can you actually have biodiversity conservation and sustainable production, and can they coexist? We undertook a review of management strategies for those outcomes. looked at the whole host of social and political factors that sit in that context and a whole series of recommendations. Now, unfortunately, these are not available anymore in hard copy. We've run out of copies, but I do have them electronically that I can share with you. I think importantly, we found as we did these strategies, there was a real lack of information, particularly for low rainfall environments. Everything was focused on high rainfall environments. So we undertook a series of case studies. There's actually five in the series, but these are two that we did in the low rainfall environments. So looking at what producers were doing to manage native grasses in those areas. So we've got Neil Sweet in case study two, which has a property near Coolabah, and the Lake Peak tree from Ellison. There's also a number of others. There's one on seed production from Bob Mars, one from the southeast, one more about horse management. And while this, there was all these questions about nutrition, and I think Bob, Paul and I had many discussions about nutrition of native grasses and their seed. And we were lucky enough to receive funding from the South Australian government to look at nutrition and also toxicological compositions of grasses and their seed. So we published a book in 2009, it's going back a bit now, looking at that details, the information. So I've just picked out a couple, and after this morning's conversation about commercial value, I took out a couple of columns here where I compared native grasses to other species, but we look at a whole range of species, both native to South Australia, but also from Northern Territory and Western Australia. So I've just picked three of them, just in comparison of their digesting. There's a whole host of forage analysis. We also look at seed and the nutritional analysis of seed. There's some real winners in that when you compare them to some of the products we're already using, such as sesame seeds. And I also must acknowledge Bob and Paul for the beautiful photos that we have of the florets and the clean down seed. And then as the producers sort of dreamed, we also looked at native grasses as an intra-row species in saltbush plantations, because most saltbush plantations you look at might visit in the upper north and Eyre Peninsula and other places in the state are find them quite close together. They tend to be rocky, they tend to have full of weeds, and the actual nutritional outcomes from that are relatively low. So we've been planting native grasses between saltbush plantations. So this is, we've already had the stipe established at that site, and then we've sown in polymigrass and medics to improve the nutrition. I wish they all looked like that. And I guess this then, has also spurred another project that we've been working on with the New North Grasslands Working Group, which looks at restoration of native grasses. So we're still using the Upper North Farming Systems broadcaster. It's not perfect, but it's the best we have. And when we're talking about tens of hectares of restoration, it certainly can do that easily. If we get how to clean the seed, we can actually get it out there. But how to make it grow if it doesn't rain, I haven't quite worked out. It's got answers I really would like to know, because I think that the one disappointment that we've had with some of this stuff is, we've tried everything we can. We always grow the seed out in a nursery condition afterwards to make sure it's viable. We just can't wait to rain. The other issue we had with this, with the Mid-North Grasslands Working Group project, which other people have talked about, is herb seed. So we actually, of course, grew some of that in second occupation areas. The other lovely aspect of that project is we've been working with producers in the Mid and Upper North to improve their grazing management. Site near Oraru, where we've worked with a number of producers on their grazing management techniques. So we've gone from a set stocking regime to what we term either rotational or strategic grazing management regime. Periods of time. this site here, I was delighted to hear that farmer's father tell me, or he overheard him telling someone, it's the first time he'd ever seen sheep on that side of the hill. And I think that, you know, we can actually even out that grazing pressure that he's having across those paddocks. And this paddock that was taken before he re-implemented Chris Fencer, and now, you know, we've seen it much, much higher. There was a cover, looked pretty good there, but the cover's improved. We've got much better perennials and much better production outcomes for the producer. This is another one from the big north. And all this wouldn't have been possible without, you know, a whole host of people. And I think the inspiration comes from those farmers of the upper north, Trevor, Ian, Neil, Kim, and there's so many more of them that are interested, but they were our four foundation farmers that sort of said there's something in these native grasses training, and they've run with it and believed in native grasses and still do. A whole host of colleagues from Rural Solutions and PERSA, past and present, some of them are actually here. And my grassy colleagues who we love to discuss all their ins and outs and how we might do it better. We've had the support of some amazing farming system groups with Upper North and Mid North Grasslands, and of course our farming systems to be able to do the research that's behind that.